the headlines, time for Windies All Rounder to step up. NBA player facing felony charges. And Pocket Rocket Foundation hands out 8 more scholarships. Good evening and welcome to the Major ZDK Sports Edition for Friday, October 30, 2020. I am your presenter, Terry Laraji. And now for the details. We begin tonight bowling off with cricket. West Indies assistant coach Roddy Eswick believes the tour of New Zealand could be a pivotal one for Roston Chase to finally assert himself as a genuine world-class all-rounder. Even while conceding that Chase had been one of the consistent performers for West Indies in recent years, Eswick said it was critical the 28-year-old now took his standard to a new level and assert himself among Test cricket's best. Eswick also stressed that Chase was a key component of the Caribbean side's batting machinery, which needed to fire on all cylinders during the upcoming 2-Test series. Chase was named West Indies Player of the Series against England earlier this year, where he made 157 runs at an average of 26 and took 10 wickets at 34. After a long journey from home, the members of the West Indies team reached New Zealand safely yesterday, passing their first health test on arrival. The Windies have now begun their 2-week quarantine period in Christchurch after the grueling 54-hour journey from Barbados. And former West Indies fast bowler Kenneth Benjamin, while speaking on yesterday's Sportsline show, said that he was very surprised Kemo Paul was selected in the Windies test squad against the Black Caps.
A bit surprised when I saw Kemo Paul. I really was surprised. When you look at the bowling unit, if you're not going to take hope, then why not take young Jaden Shields from Trinidad? He bowls 90 miles per hour. He's very excited. The pitches in New Zealand may offer some assistance for the fast bowlers. I don't see how Kemo Paul fitting into the test team. I just do not see it. So that to me is a surprise.
Jaden Shields, who is in New Zealand as a reserve player, impressed Benjamin immensely when he was assistant coach working with the Windies under-19 squad. With his raw pace that the world witnessed from Shields during the under-19s World Cup earlier this year, Benjamin feels that Paul is simply not up to test standard.
No, I don't think he's a test player. I don't think he's got that ability to stick to a plan. I think he tries too much. I don't think he's got the patience that you need at test level. He's a bits and pieces player, and I just don't see him making a big impact at the test level. His batting hasn't really taken off ever since he left on the 19th level. We haven't really seen a lot of his batting making any strides. And so I just don't know what he's in the test team as. I just do not know.
The former fast bowler also felt that Paul was lucky, as Barbadian pacer Keon Harding, who was part of the reserves for England, would have been Benjamin's pick.
It is not fair because Harding was one of the top fast bowlers in the 4-day competition. And, you know, you have to look at it. And even though we have said that we're not going to hold it against anyone if you don't go to England, as far as I'm concerned, not going to England, you actually slipped down the ranks. And that was Kemo Paul. He took him over and Jaden Shields took him over. So as far as I'm concerned, he's down the pecking order and he should not be up there. So if I was Harding, I would feel aggrieved that I got demoted for someone who had done nothing to suggest that they get a nod above me.
Benjamin also believes that wicketkeeper batsman Joshua De Silva was another who was unlucky to have missed out.
Also a surprise to me is that De Silva, even if you drop Sheehope out, De Silva is not in. You know, so that to me is a surprise. And you're going to take Durridge, who I know they will target in terms of the short pitch. Maybe he has done some work on it. But I just felt De Silva did enough in England to merit automatic selection in that team.
Kenneth Benjamin. The 22-year-old De Silva, who was part of a 6-man reserve group for the New Zealand series, was also a reserve for the Tour of England, where he shone in an inter-squad match at Manchester with an unbeaten 100 and half century. He gathered 502 runs at an average of 50 for Trinidad and Tobago Red Force in the last regional first-class season, scoring his maiden century batting at number 5. West Indies hold the edge over New Zealand in the T20 Internationals, but will be facing an uphill battle in the Test Series, according to CWI CEO Johnny Grave. Grave saw the T20 International Series as very much now the real 12-month roadmap between now and that T20 World Cup that is taking place next year in India. With West Indies being the defending champions, Grave believes that title will be well represented. Meantime, as part of the Skerrett Shallow Administration Cricket First Plan, CWI are working hard between tours on technical aspects of a player's game. CWI CEO Johnny Graves stated that looking after players in this way is vital to rebuilding the game.
Look after players, how we prepare them, how we work on, you know, technical issues or things that the coaching staff identify as areas of weakness where improvement can be made. You know, in between tours and tournament is really key period. Yes, as Jason said, you know, there needs to be a time to, you know, get away from cricket and reflect and recuperate and re-energise, but then also a period of technical and also physical preparation so that the next tour you're better prepared for the challenges that come thick and fast at international level. So we're trying to do that essentially. We have to increase and continue to increase capacity at regional level, strengthen our franchising systems, and that work is ongoing.
Johnny Grave. Late last year, CWA employed Australian Chris Brabazon as a coach education manager to plan and develop all coaches around the Caribbean to be on the same page with coaching methods. And the ICC is continuing with its push for a return of cricket to the Olympics, having recently asked all its members to report on the potential financial benefits of inclusion. A questionnaire sent to all ICC members asked them to quantify the potential financial support they could expect to receive each year from their government and respective Olympic organizations if the sport's inclusion was confirmed. The template also asked members to distinguish between the support available if the sport was accepted to the Games on a permanent basis or on a one-off basis. The forms need to be returned by November 2, with the results set to be discussed at the next ICC board meeting later in the month. The ICC has yet to agree a future tours program beyond 2023. A women's cricket tournament, however, will be held at the 2020 Commonwealth Games in Birmingham, England, during July and August 2022. Meantime, Pakistan withstood a stunning fight back, led by century maker Brendan Taylor, to hang on for a thrilling 26-run victory in the first one-day international against Zimbabwe and Royal Pindi today. Scores Pakistan 281 for 8, Sahel 71, Imam ul Haq 58, Chisoro 2 for 31. Zimbabwe 255 all out of 49.4 overs, Taylor 112, Madhaveri 55, Afridi 5 for 49, Wahab 4 for 41. Pakistan leads the three-match series 1-0. The second match bowls off on Sunday. And West Indies and Kings XI Punjab star batsman Chris Gayle reached a record 1,000 T20 sixes after a scintillating performance against Rajasthan Royals in the IPL today. Gayle reached the mark in 66 deliveries, with the record boundary coming off the bowling of Jofra Archer. Gayle, however, was bowled on 99 by Archer before a breathtaking half-century from Ben Stokes and a perfectly paced 48 from Sanju Samson trumped Gayle to keep the Rajasthan Royals alive in the playoff race with a 7-wicket win. Scores Rajasthan Royals 186 for 3 off 17.3 overs, Stokes 50, Samson 48, beat Kings XI Punjab 185 for 4, Gayle 99, Rahul 46, Archer 2 for 26, Stokes 2 for 32. The victory took the Royals to 12 points, level with the Kings XI and the Kolkata Knight Riders, and help them jump from 7th to 5th place. Meantime, Surrey's African Caribbean Engagement ACE program is to be established as an independent charity after receiving significant backing from Sport England. The ACE program, set up earlier this year to offer cricketing opportunities to boys and girls from Africa-Caribbean backgrounds, will receive £540,000 over a 3-year period from Sport England. The funds will allow the program, chaired by Sky Sports pundit and the first black woman to play for England, Ebony Rainford Brent, to employ 4 full-time staff, building grassroots programs, talent pathways and better talent ID within black communities, and also providing elite academy programs and scholarships to talented players to allow them to fulfill their potential. In other sporting developments tonight, pedaling into cycling, the Roadrunners Cycling Club will be hosting a 10x10 family fun ride on Sunday, November 1, Antigua and Barbuda's Independence Day. President of Roadrunners Alistair Savory, while speaking on ZDK Sportsline Show, said that the event targets riders in all different bike categories while sticking to the standard protocols.
The 10-10 family fun ride, that's 10 kilometers if you're on a mountain bike and 10 miles if you're on a road bike. We encourage people to bring helmets, but it's not mandatory, but we encourage people to be, you know, on the safe side prior. We will be dividing the riders into groups of 20 with a chaperone, and they will be set off at 10. Each group will go 10 minutes to 15 minutes apart, and the police are working with us on this.
Alistair Savory. The event will roll off from the sponsors Island Provisions Limited car park at 7:30 a.m. with registration commencing an hour earlier. Shooting into basketball, Minnesota Timberwolves guard Malik Beasley is facing felony charges after an alleged assault rifle pointing incident outside his home. The 23-year-old has been charged with felony threats of violence and fifth-degree drug possession. Each charge carries a maximum sentence of 5 years in prison. On Thursday, the Hennepin County District Attorney's Office announced the charges relating to last month's incident. According to their report, on September 26, Beasley allegedly had the encounter with a couple as they drove through his neighborhood in Plymouth, Minnesota on a tour of homes. Serving into tennis, and another sports person who was in trouble with the law, U.S. Open finalist Alexander Zverev has denied his ex-girlfriend's allegations he was violent towards her. Olya Sharapova claimed Zverev tried to strangle her with a pillow in an attack before the 2019 U.S. Open that she says left her afraid for her life. The German called the accusations unfounded and simply not true. Meantime, world number one Novak Djokovic suffered a shock defeat by Italy's Lorenzo Sonego in the quarterfinals of the Vienna Open. The Serb was beaten 6-2, 6-1 by the world number 42, who only came into the tournament as a lucky loser. Djokovic looked out of sorts in the opening set as Sonego took control. The Italian kept up the intensity in the second set, a double break putting him 4-1 up, and he held his nerve for a famous win. It's the first time Djokovic has ever been beaten by a lucky loser. Kicking into football now, Barcelona presidential frontrunner Victor Font wants Pep Guardiola to return to the club and has no doubt Lionel Messi will stay. Current president Josep Maria Bartomeu resigned earlier this week, along with his board of directors, ahead of an expected vote of no confidence next month. It comes after months of widespread criticism over the club's worsening finances and the team's decline on the pitch, which came to a head with their 8-2 defeat to Bayern Munich in the Champions League quarterfinals in August. Font has quickly become the frontrunner to succeed Bartomeu and exclusively told Sky Sports News he has a clear plan to bring back the glory days to the La Liga giants, involving the old Barca dynasty, breathing new life into the current one. Meantime, Arsenal eventually broke Dundalk's resistance as goals either side of the break secured a 3-0 victory in their Europa League group game at Emirates Stadium last night, while Jamie Vardy became Leicester City's oldest European goalscorer as they beat AEK Athens 2-1 to make it 2 wins from 2. And the Premier League has extended its pay-per-view model to matches on November 6 to 8, but will review the service after the international break. The scheme has been criticised by a number of supporters and pundits, with fans donating to food banks instead of paying the £14.95 fee. Games had previously been on free-to-air when the Premier League returned. Meanwhile, Paris Saint-Germain president Nasser Al-Khelaifi has been cleared of corruption after a trial in Switzerland. Al-Khelaifi, who is also chairman of the Be In Media Group, had been accused of giving gifts to former FIFA Secretary-General Jerome Valcke in order to secure broadcast rights for the 2026 and 2030 World Cups. Valcke was found guilty of forging documents relating to TV rights. He was given a 120-day suspended sentence. Meantime, Portugal and Juventus forward Cristiano Ronaldo has recovered from coronavirus, testing negative after self-isolating. Diving into swimming, Alia Atkinson has been named co-captain for London Roar's second round of competition set to begin in England tonight. Atkinson was impressive on debut for the International Swimming League franchise, winning the 50-metre breaststroke on October 18. She was also a member of the Roar's winning 4x100-metre medley relay team. The affable Jamaican swimming star said she was humbled by the appointment. And into athletics, 8 Jamaican high school student athletes had more than 400,000 reasons to smile on Wednesday when they were named recipients of scholarships for the remainder of their high school years by the Pocket Rocket Foundation, run by four-time 100-meter world champion Shelly-Ann Fraser-Price. The 2020 scholarship awardees were sixth-form students, and these 8 will join the 12 current student athletes on scholarship, which means that the foundation is supporting 20 scholarship recipients for the duration of their high school education. To date, a total of 50 scholarships have been awarded through the foundation. Touching down in Gridiron in the first match of NFL's Week 8 last night, the Falcons defeated the Panthers 25-17. Meantime, the Denver Broncos postponed a planned practice on Friday as a precaution after a player tested positive for COVID-19. As they prepare for Sunday's home game against the LA Chargers, the Broncos will hold virtual meetings while operating under the league's coronavirus protocols amid the health pandemic. Denver also confirmed that the individual who tested positive is now in self-isolation, as are 2 other players deemed to have been in close contact. And finally tonight, on this day in history, in 1962, birth of the most durable bowler of all time. Courtney Andrew Walsh started off doing the donkey work for more naturally gifted practitioners like Malcolm Marshall and Curtly Ambrose, but through skill, cunning, and an unparalleled appetite for hard work, he became the top man. His first 63 tests yielded 5 fifers, his last 69 brought a further 17, and the first bowler to take 500 test wickets. His career had plenty of highlights, sealing the famous one-run victory with a snorter to Craig McDermott in Adelaide in 1992-93, that frightening spell to Mike Atherton in Jamaica in 93-94, almost single-handedly keeping West Indies' unbeaten run alive in India a year later in the absence of Ambrose, 13 for 55 in Wellington the same winter, his delirious celebration when he hoodwinked Graham Thorpe with a slower ball at Old Trafford in 2000, and the historic 500th wicket Jacques Callis trapped in front second ball in Trinidad in 2001. A thoroughly decent, hugely popular man, Walsh also gave outstanding service to Gloucestershire between 1985 and 1998. He has now been appointed as head coach of the West Indies women's team. And that story has brought us to the end of our sporting developments for tonight. Now to recap our top story. West Indies assistant coach Roddy Eswick believes the tour in New Zealand could be a pivotal one for Austin Chase to finally assert himself as a genuine world-class all-rounder. I have been your presenter, Terry Laraji. Thank you for listening. To watch the DK Sports Package, go to the YouTube channel of Terry Laraji, The Straight Bat, and subscribe. Stay tuned now for your Voice of America update. Do enjoy the rest of your evening and have a great Independence Day long weekend. Rally round the West Indies. One for all.